draw presenting Warri Federal Constituency in the House of Rep. Mr. Speaker of the Federal State House of Assembly, my Indian Party Chairman, State Chairman, Mr. Sassoon, members of the House of Assembly, members of the State Executive Council, my very distinguished chiefs who are here in good numbers, our leaders, our women, our youths, and every other invited guest, gentlemen of the press, ladies and gentlemen. I'm truly glad that I'm here with you today in continuation of our town hall meetings across the state. We actually started this sometime last year, and this is the 20th local government that we have visiting, interacting with our people, sharing ideas with them, and listening to them. When we started this, I felt it was a good idea. We are going through 20 local government areas. I'm better impressed that it's just more than a good idea. Because the town hall meetings have afforded us the opportunity to hear from our people. I do know that persons are elected to represent you. I know that persons are appointed from various local government council areas also represent you. By talking with the people across the 20 local governments we visited, we can see that though we are addressing some of the issues we ought to address, but there are some other areas critical to the lives of the people that are missed out. And this town hall meetings have continued to afford us the opportunity. And I must thank you for coming out in good numbers. This is a select audience. I know that we are going to give room for people to talk more. But listening to the local government council chairman and to two of our leaders who have spoken today, obviously I already have a lot of takeaway from this meeting that can help to improve on the governance structure of our dear states. So I thank you all. We are in office to serve the people. And this interactive session is welcome. And I want to plead with you, we may not be able to speak with everybody, but for those who speak, please try to be brief, go straight to the point, forget the recognition, don't even recognize me, go ahead and speak after I've spoken, so that we'll be in a position to listen to a few persons or a lot of persons within the course of the time that we'll have the interactive session. As a government, we came at a very difficult time, even as the local government council chairman has said. There is no time for us to lament about the times. We have continued to work hard, and I'm convinced that as of today, we have gone past the very difficult times, and we have come into a time of building, a time of impacting on the lives of our people. We had a difficult first 2 years, very, very difficult because of the challenges of low oil prices, and more importantly then, the challenge of very reduced oil production because of the destruction of our pipelines. But since October 2017, which is just about 5 months ago, things have started to improve, and I believe, by the special grace of God, that will remain improving on a daily basis going ahead into the future. So I want to thank our people for the patience and their partnership with us even at the very difficult times. And this is our prayer and hope that we will continue to meet with the needs of our people as we move forward. However, in the last 2 years, despite the very difficult situation, there is no doubt that we have started a lot of things that will touch on the lives of our youths and what we call our youth job creation program. Yes, I can see by 2,304 is already trained and equipped. 745 currently on training. And by special grace of God, the fourth batch will also come into the training program between now and the end of May, latest June this year. Why have we engaged in that program? Because we believe that we can continue to encourage our youths to be job creators on their own. And those training programs have impacted a lot on people. We have had good successes. That does not mean that a few of them have not also fallen out of the program. But we have had a lot of success, and not less than 80% of them are currently succeeding. And we are aware that there are challenges even after you have been trained and you have been empowered. And that is why we have what we call the Directorate of Mentoring and Monitoring that continues to monitor those who have exited from the program and have been established. And we have continued to have success stories. Even in the month of January, we now have to organize a business fair for the products of this program. And it was likely very successful, and it's our intention every year to organize a business fair for those who have graduated from this program and are beginning to employ and to train other youths on their own. The program is that extensive that after the training on mindset change and skill acquisition and the establishment of the people, we spend, depending on the type of enterprise that you're in, the state government spends between 500,000 and close to 2.something million on each individual, depending on the product type, because some are more expensive than others. And the good stories we have had is that many of them are doing well. I will thank God for that. On the infrastructure, yes, we have commissioned a few projects in the course of this visit yesterday. I also know that we had also come before to commission the Okere roads and some other places. It is our intention to reach out to all communities. We will not ignore any. But because of the challenges of funding, we have had our constraints. But now that things are improving, we will definitely reach other places, and we will, I want to assure you that we will reach Agbara in Jesus' name. It's not deliberate, but you have to start from somewhere. And Commissioner for Works, I hope you are hearing that you have not reached Agbara. You have not, because you are supposed to be the person that proposes programs to the community. The ongoing projects that are also strong, of major importance to us include the Ubeji Road. I learned that the women were waiting for me in Ubeji yesterday. I apologize. The reason I didn't get there is because the road leading to Ubeji itself has actually, the top of work in that place has not picked up as much as I expected it to be. And I have cautioned the contractor and he's given me a firm promise that where he is now will take him about 1 week to complete at the roundabout and he'll move to the Ubeji Road. So I'll be in Ubeji in a short while, a few weeks from now. But that will be when that road, the contractor has actually mobilized to that road and is working. It's not just moving around, it's not to see our people and to see the women. I love seeing our people. But it is more about that which will impact on their lives. And I believe that the contractor has been put under pressure and will be moving to the Ubeji Road in a very short while. We are committed to the Transwarri Road project. I have had in the palace yesterday of the Lord for it to speak about it. Our challenge is that we met that the contractor was owed over 8 million naira. And when a contractor is owed over 8 billion naira, you expect him in very difficult times to continue. It's not possible. We have been negotiating and talking about it. And what we first had to do was that at that time we came in, the coronation of the Ubeji Road was to take place. We had to plead with them and we released the sum of 1 billion naira at that time to pay to advance to the contractor. We pleaded for them to construct the internal roads in Ode Ishekiri. And I'm glad to say that that was done because I witnessed it myself when I came in for the coronation. Now we are in the process of negotiating the continuation of that contract. First, the state government will have to show its goodwill. And the goodwill is that if you are owing somebody as much as 8 billion, we have to be able to pay a reasonable part of that money, then we can urge him to continue. Because it's going to take quite some money. Because beyond that 8 billion, we require another 7.5 billion to complete that road. And what we have just done recently is to release the sum of 1.5 billion to the contractor. We are sourcing another 1.5 billion. And by the time we are paying 3 billion naira out of the 8 billion, I can conveniently demand that the contractor returns fully back to site. And I'm sure that they will do so. And we are hoping that that money will be able to pay very soon. On education, we will be doing our best to reach out to our schools. We are moving more and more into technical education, and we believe that it is very important for our people. Generally in the state, we have rehabilitated our 6 technical colleges, and we are making it very fully functional. The enrollment figures have gone up, and we believe that that is the way to go. Because beyond the fact that technical colleges offer the normal secondary education, they also impart skills on our people. And if we move from there and want to go further, we'll move into the polytechnics, and we are able to acquire even greater skills and to be able to stand on our own when we come out, rather than taking pieces of paper that we call certificate, moving around from office to office. We need to begin to change our minds to make our youth realize that they can stand on their own after their university education or after their polytechnic education or even after the education colleges, that they can truly stand on their own. And I believe that they can. In this sense of our technical colleges recently, I was very impressed at the work that they are doing, even while they are yet students. Because today, our technical colleges are able to compete with contractors in the production of the benches that we use in our secondary schools, and I'm happy and excited at that. In places like Opawe, our students who are in the technical college have been engaged with their teachers to build houses for people, and they are doing well. This is the kind of thing we need to impact on the people. Because if all of us begin to wait, at the end of the day, government will employ us. It will be a wrong step that we are taking, because that will not be able to continue. We already have over 50,000 people in government employment, which is already at least 20,000 in excess of what we need. So begin to believe that government will continue to engage people, we will be going on the wrong path. And that is why as a nation, we spend almost all our money in paying salaries, and there is no money left for development. Our higher institutions are also doing very well. And today we have been able, through the university system, to get full accreditation for the law school, full accreditation for the engineering faculty, and recently we have gotten full accreditation for the School of Health Sciences. These 3 major courses, we got the full accreditation within this short time of our tenure in government. And it's important. I'm glad that the Ekotodo Youth Center and Okobo Center has come back to life. People will ask what happened initially. When I came in, I found that for every year, the state government will need to spend over 500 million naira in support of that institution, the way it was being run. And that was something that we were not able to continue in that manner. So we had to reorder it in such a manner that we can spend less money and run the center and also run it efficiently. So so we had to enter into discussions with our partners, UNDP, and we have been able to come out with a workable system that impacts on the youths, that trains the youths at much less money than that was initially being spent. And I'm glad to announce that we have agreed and the system will run, and there was never an intention to close down the center. It's just that we needed to make it more cost efficient in the course of our activities. In the health sector, we're doing what we can. As I've told us, the finances of the state is improving, and we will definitely run and do much more. So the Warri Hospital, obviously, will take a pace to it in short while, because Commissioner has already informed me, we have a new commissioner. He's going around all the hospitals and is bringing up his report, and it is our intention to make the Warri Central Hospital the masterpiece that it should continue to be. We cannot allow it to run down, because we know the importance of that institution, not only to Warri and its environment, but we also know the importance of that institution to the continuing of the medical studies of our students in the university. And the workload and the patient load in Warri Central Hospital is high. And for the Ogalateke Hospital to truly, fully survive, and for the medical school to continue, the partnership of the Warri Central Hospital is obviously needed. So we will be attending to the institution very, very soon. Concerning the Warri streetlights, I apologize that when we came in, we were in darkness also, because at that moment, we were struggling to pay salaries. In fact, for 2 years, almost all states were paying salaries, including Delta State. The only reason our state workers were able to manage it was because we were able to find out what we call net salary. So in the net salary, we were paying the salary that enters into the account of the worker. Then all other deductions could be meant for other purposes like welfare and the rest, we were not able to pay because the situation was very bad. But we managed it, working with the workers, and we continued. But at least at the state level, as at December 2017, we have able to pay all salaries that is due our workers, and we own no worker at the state. We are now working with the local government councils to ensure that we begin to clear their own backlog. But on a regular basis now, every month, in the last 9 months, every month, the local government councils have been able to pay their salaries consistently. And we are beginning to gradually clear their arrears, and it is our hope that we will go very far in clearing those arrears in the course of this year, 2018. I must appreciate the people of Warri South and all Deltans for the peace that we enjoy today in Delta State. There is nothing as good as peace. And since we became peaceful, we realize that a lot more is being done by the state. And I want to thank our traditional rulers, I want to thank our chiefs. I must appreciate our women and our youths. And also, our religious leaders for all that we have done to enable us to achieve the peace that we enjoy at the moment. And I want to plead with us that we continue to ensure that we remain peaceful, because in peace we shall develop much faster than we have done in the previous 2 years. The council chairman did make a request concerning the Okuangwe and Obito markets, and that the state government should hand it over to them. I want a formal request. It is only on the formal request in paper that we're able to understand it, and then we'll see what we can do. In Ugeni North, I've already directed the secretary of state government that they should hand over the Ugeni local market back to the local government council. You know, sometimes we know how to do our own things. I knew that they may want to give me one reason or the other why I cannot hand it over. So I had to pronounce it before the people. So by pronouncing it before the people, I tie their hands. They cannot change. They cannot change it. That's what we call an executive order. So by God's grace, we'll do what is right to enable the council to have the matters, because the state government, as it is constituted, cannot properly run any markets. And markets, by our constitution, are supposed to be run by the local government councils. We can assist in helping to build and helping to renovate, but it is for the local government councils to run their markets. So we'll look into that, and I'll discuss with you about the renovation of markets that we talked about. We'll discuss it and see where we can intervene as a state. On the street lights, really, when we came in, we also found that it cost a huge sum of money to maintain the street lights, because they were being run on generators. And by our own thinking, and because we are in times where the monies are not as it ought to be, as used to be, we thought that it was not practicable to run a street light with generators. But now we are stabilizing, and what we're doing is reconverting the entire system to transformer-based power supply and reconnecting it to the 33 line, which is a more sustainable line and which we believe will meet the needs of our people. We have gone very far on that project. In fact, I was the contractor yesterday, Income Electrics, and he has promised me that it's going to go far. Unfortunately, during the years that we did not have the street lights on, a lot of vandalization has been done. And the project, even as awarded, we thank God that there is a lot more required to complete the project. In fact, from the estimates I was given by the contractor yesterday, it was staggering. But we are committed to it, and we are giving a go ahead for me to complete the project and for us as a state to put the papers right and find ways to pay for it. So we are committed to having all the street lights and Warri back to a functional state, and that is the situation. I believe that project, from what I'm told, should be completed. Commissioner for Energy, when are you completing the project? No, when are you completing? Don't give me history. I mean, answer my question. Don't create your own question.
Maybe within this month.
Let me help you. It is my prayer. We will work hard for the way that the contractor did say. I don't think it will take me too much, because I've already committed him to go ahead. It is for the Ministry of Energy to look at his papers and his costing. But I am convinced that before May 29, 2018, that is next month, that project will be fully completed. Then one of our leaders talked about the three aisles. Jokingly, when you were talking about it, jokingly, I said, is it because the rural ethnic account does not have an eye? But I don't know that what we do to make it the four eyes, we'll call it eye rural. And the truth is that he has made the point. The rurals in Warri South are in Warri South in the Dry District. We cannot wish them away. Neither can we call them people from Delta Central. So if we agree that they are in Delta South, it is only important that their recognition as an ethnic group in Delta South be made public, and that in every relationship they will have to be there. But what is going on, I think, is the politicians that are creating those issues. Either community politicians or party politicians like TDP, APC. But I believe that most people within the traditional space will recognize that they are poor, that robots are there. So I hope that the politicians that are here will correct that. If you are planning to talk, you want an easy way. You want an easy way out, you are saying, there, just pretend that it is I Urubu and then maybe four eyes. But jokingly, that is on the joking aspect of it. But I think that you have made the point, and I believe that point is noted by the checkers, the jaws, and the soko. They know that the robots exist, and they cannot wish you away, and I don't think that is their plan. Possibly they were looking for the easy way out. That is why they decided to call three eyes. So I also hope that we will correct the situation going forward. The traditional rulers, it's not council, probably you're talking about the traditional rulers committee. It's only that that is called the council. I think the council chairman must have listened to you, and I think that there is a need. It's a law. It's a law, and it must be done. The traditional rulers committee has to be constituted. It cannot be thrown away. It is a law of the state, and it's a law that must be obeyed. On appointments into council, I cannot sit here now and tell you that I preside over the appointments of local government council, because it's a tier of government. I can only advise them from behind and not in this manner. I don't want to play. Just as the President Warri cannot come to me and discuss and tell me this is how you appoint people. But it's possible for him to advise me the lead of the rights from behind. So I'll sit with the political class and offer my needed advice, but I will not, as government, pretend that I control the local government council and decide the appointments there. But where there is justice, there will always be friendship. So I will offer the advice as necessary. The Magaleyas were trying to start up some projects in the Magaleyas, and we will, as I say, also look into projects within, because the man that spoke to Agbara said that we don't have any projects in commission. By God's grace, the next time that I'm going to come either to the town hall meeting or come for other things, there will be things to commission in the Agbara area. So, Commissioner, for what this thing will be, I hope you know. I may not know the intricacies. I know that the communities will exist, but the road networks that belong to Agbara. I do not know all that. I'm still learning when it comes to the road distribution, but he should know more because he lives here. The other request made, I'm taking note of it. I will see what we can do, especially if you have only one public secondary school. I think that obviously is not enough, and will definitely create a lot of problems. The same kind of thing that we have in Asaba, we will look at and see what we can do. So, Commissioner for Basic Education, Chego, you see here? Chego, I hope you're taking that very seriously, because you say they have only one public secondary school, and definitely that is not good enough for that area. For the abandoned projects, we'll go back. Thank God we have listed and we'll go back studying the file and know, because it could be a lot that contractors have abandoned. We'll go back studying the file and we want to assure you that actions will be taken on them on a gradual basis, either by bringing the contractors back to site or by replicating the contracts and reawarding them to other persons who will do a much better job in the course of going forward. But before I sit down to take up comments, there is what we call the contributory health scheme that has been started in Delta State. We started the law when we came in, we called it Delta State Contributory Health Commission Law. And that law
request that every Delta will have to have one form of health insurance or the other. Starting as a government, we have identified some groups we call the vulnerable group. That includes women who are pregnant, children who are under 5 years of old, and the state government is paying the premium for this set of people. Other Deltas will have to pay their own premium. If the amount is reasonable enough, I think it's not a little less than 7,000 naira a year. And which can be paid in small amounts, you don't have to pay it once to get engaged in the program. And once you're enrolled into the program, it means that at any point in time, if you're sick, you will receive treatment in all our public, in all our hospitals, and also in the accredited primary health care centers without having to pay any further money. Please get enrolled in that program, because it's very important and it's key for the health of our people. The civil servants are all enrolled now. Many other groups are working with the informal sector and the organized private sector to get people enrolled. And I hope that our people will take this opportunity on hand to ensure that they are able to better their health going into the future. I want to once again thank the people of the South Local Government Council and to urge you to work very closely with the Local Government Council Chairman to ensure the peace in Warri South and the cleanliness in Warri South Local Government Council area. I know that there is a lengthy process for everybody, but I'm confident in the Local Government Council Chairman that you have, that he will listen when you advise. It's my son, and if he does wrong, report him to me, and I'll be able to correct him along the line. But I am sure that he's somebody who is learning, and somebody who learns very fast, and I believe that he's ready to work with each and every one of you. God bless you.